Welcome to Business Innovators Radio, featuring industry influencers and trendsetters sharing proven strategies to help you build a better life right now.
Hello and welcome to today's show. This is Mike Saunders with Marketing Huddle. And today we have with us a special guest, Chris Miles with Money Ripples. Welcome to the show, Chris.
Yeah, thanks for having me on.
Hey, you're welcome. Well, let's just get started with tell us a little bit about yourself. How long have you been in business? What got you started into this area? Given that it's money, you probably have a financial background, but what made you break into a business on your own and writing a book?
Yeah, so I did intentionally go into a financial background. It kind of found me a little bit. I actually went to school majoring in sociology, and I had a potential triple minor in psychology, Japanese, and ballroom dancing.
So, now that is a book in and of itself.
It sure is. But, you know, my whole intention was to become a business consultant. And I figured, while I was starting to get towards the end of college, I thought, well, if I'm going to really become a business consultant, I should have real life experience, not just book experience. So I ended up dropping out of school, and the first opportunity that came up to become a business owner was to become a financial planner. That was the first opportunity with one of my friends, you know, told me. He said, hey, he just got hired at a firm. I said, hey, I'd love to have an internship or whatever it takes to get there, and didn't realize it was that easy to become a financial advisor. You just had to get licenses, and that actually started to become my career. I did that for 4 years. Back in the early 2000s. And I actually dropped out of school. I didn't go back. I stayed as an entrepreneur. I went to go back later, but when they told me, hey, it's been 5 years, we want you to take a year and a half's worth of school when all I had was one class left, I said, the heck with that. Sociology major, I'll make way less money. So I stayed out of school. And what really shifted for me was in early 2006, you know, I started to see the writing on the wall because I'd been a financial advisor for 4 years. Mm-hmm. And I saw that what was being taught wasn't working. I mean, people with decades of advice weren't much better off than people that didn't have that kind of advice. And I started to realize, I'm like, well, what's really working? I looked around and I found, you know, people that I knew that were millionaires. And I found out that they didn't just think differently about money. They thought the exact opposite. And I thought, well, if I want real experience, things that really work, I shouldn't just, you know, believe people that are selling you financial products. They're just salesmen in a suit, which is what I basically was. You know, I should trust people that actually are doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I
find that
March 06.
When you mention about people noticing things just kind of going over and over and getting the same results, and people giving kind of the same advice, do you feel that that is because it's almost like a human nature sort of approach where you just kind of get in that rut and do the same old thing? And it's like the old saying, you know, do you have 10 years of experience or do you have 1 year of experience 10 times over, meaning you never are growing or developing or learning new things? So in the financial services world, maybe, you know, from the top down, they cookie cutter tell you what to do and you offer this and it's like next, here you go, next. Is that kind of what you were seeing?
That's exactly what I was seeing. Yeah, I remember taking out, well, a guy that was a financial advisor in the company I was with before I quit, he took me out to lunch a few years back and he said, Chris, what is it you teach differently today than you did when you were with us?
Mm.
I said, well, it's pretty easy. You know, let me ask you, you've been in the business for 35 years. It's the late 70s. Where have you made the most money? In your business or in the investments you've been recommending people be in for the last 35 years?
Hmm.
And without hesitation, guess what he said?
The business.
His business.
Yep.
Yeah. He said his business. And I said, that's the difference between you and me. You're telling people to invest in things like their businesses and in themselves, which has worked for us. Therefore, I'm the only one in integrity here.
Mm.
And it was a pretty silent lunch from that moment on.
Was it literally silent, or did that spur him on to go, ooh, we need to keep talking about this? Or was he so kind of embarrassed that it just was like crickets?
It was awkward. Yeah, it was crickets.
Yes. Wow.
I mean, we talked a little bit, but it was more we got off the subject because he didn't want to hear it. I mean, his whole life had been invested in that. And I get it. I mean, I had only 4 years of my life, but kind of like you said, he was repeating 1 year 35 times.
Yeah.
With me, as I started learning and grow, I started to see things because I like evidence. I like things to see if they really work. And I, you know, I told him, I said, hey, I've learned things that, you know, if you're going to create real wealth, it's not by following your advice. It's not following the guys on TV. It's not like following the Susie Ormans and the Dave Ramseys. Those people are okay, and they can help some people, but you're not going to create wealth listening to them. You're going to end up doing the opposite.
Mm. Well, it's kind of like also the old saying, knowledge is power, is really a fallacy, because knowledge is potential power. You have to do something with it. And, you know, taking those principles and, you know, I'm all for learning a nugget from this one and a nugget from that speaker and making it your own, but you got to actually make it your own and put it into action. So your website and your focus in your business is cash flow. What makes you the cash flow expert? What is that focus on?
We know really the real life experience. You know, I've had different experiences where I've been in the hole by, you know, $16,000 in the month before, you know, between my personal and my business, meaning that I was making $5,000 or $6,000 a month, but my income, my expenses were $21,000, $22,000 a month, trying to keep things running. So I've been there, and I've also been, you know, I've also been on the opposite side of the spectrum where that same year, 2006, you know, March is when I was when I quit being a financial advisor and I vowed never to do financial things again. But it was July of 06, I was able to retire with just $2,000 in my checking account. And so what I realized, it has nothing to do with how much money you have saved up, because really net worth and all that stuff that people focus on has no true meaning. It's really based on how wise of a steward are you. And that really stewards focus on cash flow. How do we create and generate income? And especially where income is drastically more than expenses. That's where real financial freedom comes from.
And you know, so, I think people they misinterpret financial freedom. And the misperception is I have a big chunk of money sitting in the bank. I have no debts and I can go run to the beaches of the world and have as much money to spend as I want because I've got a big old chunk of money. But if I'm hearing you correctly, your point that you're trying to get to people is you have, let's call it manageable debts, although I believe in being completely debt-free, including the mortgage. But at the, at that point, let's say that you had zero debt, it costs to live. My dad and grandfather were famous for saying, well, it costs to live. Well, it does. You have property taxes, homeowner's insurance. Even if your house is paid off, you have to eat your kids and college and braces and food. So your point is, have things in balance and have enough business income, personal income, that the cash flow covers your living expenses plus whatever you need to do, whatever you want. And you've mentioned a couple keywords, you know, steward and you know, I liken that to the kingdom focus. And as Christians, we would need to take that and say, God, what would you have me to do? Because if you felt the tug on your heart to go do a 3-week mission trip and take a check over to the missionary for $2,000 and not ask your local church to pay your way over there, who could do that? Not many people.
No. Yeah, I had a huge epiphany in 2006. Now, let me preface it by this, because, you know, there's really three types of perspectives around money. Two of them are based in scarcity, and scarcity drives money out of your life. You can never have financial freedom in scarcity. The only one of them actually has abundance. The first one that's in scarcity is being a spender. Now, spenders aren't too hard to figure out. I mean, they blow money when they're given extra money. They usually get a bad rap, more so than the other perspectives, just because, you know, financial experts and so, you know, quote unquote, they never like spenders, right? But in some ways, spenders got it right. On the flip side, there's the saver. Savers are also in scarcity. This is where all the financial advice you hear in the media comes from. You can never pay off debt fast enough. You can never save enough. You will never have enough to ever be financially free. That's where you say it doesn't really matter. And heck, you can even be cash flow based, you know, financially independent, but not be financially free, because you never feel like it's enough. There's always that scarcity. There's always that fear. If you fear debt now, you will fear debt and you'll fear money later. Like, you will never be financially free. I've seen it time and time again, because I was one of them. You know, the real way to create real abundance is to be a steward. And that's what you were kind of describing. A steward takes the best of the spender and the saver and they put it into one person. Because money is meant to be used. People that hoard and cash money away in banks forever are actually destroying the kingdom of God. They're actually doing more harm than good. I realized this when I was retired. I could have just sat back and done nothing the rest of my life, because, or doing very little, because I was working like 3 hours a week, making $4,000 or $5,000 a month. I could have been just happy taking care of my family doing that. But the thing is that when I remember when I got to that point, I remember thinking, well, what am I going to do with my life? Like, how am I going to really make a difference? I can be the most selfish person and just take care of my needs. Like every person would tell me when I was a financial advisor, Chris, if I can just take care of my family and not worry about money, that's all I really want. Do you know how selfish that really is? You know how narrow-minded and focused on yourself that really is? What about the rest of the people around you? I believe that we're sent to this earth to bless people's lives. That is our purpose in life, using our unique gifts and talents and abilities to be a blessing and to build up the kingdom.
We
so
know you
to
mentioned
do that,
talent.
That's why you need to be a steward.
I couldn't agree more. And when you mentioned talent, it reminds me of the parable of the talents. And I feel that talents in that parable is money. But you're saying talents is for skills and abilities. Well, one time I heard, we've heard the message in church about the parable of the talents over and over. And, well done, my good and faithful servant. Well, one time I heard a message that I had never heard before about it, and it really resonated with me. So maybe you've heard this point as well. The steward that, put the money in the ground, and he was the bad one.
Mm-hmm.
The one that, took the, two to turn it into three, and then the one that five to ten. The point is they got praised because they did something with it. But do you realize the element in that it took to get that praise was risk? Because they had to do something to double their money from 5 to 10 or 2 to 4 or whatever the numbers were. You don't just put it in because Jesus said, why didn't you just put it in the bank and earn some interest? So they did more than that. They did something. They took risk. They invested. They bought goods, sold goods for profit, and then gave him the difference. Wow. We're sitting here going, Maybe I need to step out of my comfort zone, and that might be personally, it might be business-wise to take risks, but I would add in there calculated risks. We want to make sure that it's not just willy-nilly risk, but we need to say we've been put on this earth for a mission to glorify God in all that we do. How can I use my talents and maybe step out of comfort zone, maybe take a little bit of risk, calculated risk? What are your thoughts around that concept?
Oh, my goodness. I love the parable of talents because there's so many lessons within it. First one is just to kind of answer what you're saying there with risk. The thing is, like what you're saying, I like how you say calculated risk because people will believe a falsehood that high risk creates high returns, which is completely false. How does a higher chance of losing create a higher chance of winning?
Yeah, that's gambling.
When people are telling you high risk creates high. Yeah, that's gambling. And most people when they're saving in 401ks and IRAs and mutual funds and things like that are gamblers. They're trying to save into a gambling type of investment. It's not really investment. It's a savings plan. An investment, same thing, requires your time, your energy, and or your money.
Mm-hmm.
And especially if you could put your own time and energy into it, you'll find out you get a better return. That's how I was able to retire, is that I wasn't just gambling into some crazy investment that somebody else is doing. I created the investment myself. I was the investment, right? And I'd rather bet on that than on some market that I can't control. Just like in the movie Cinderella Man. He's like, hey, at least let me get beat up in the ring. At least I know who's hitting me.
Yep.
Right? So that's where I see what you're saying on calculated risk. That's how I see it too. The other thing too is interesting about the parable of talents is if you think about it, all three of the servants were in debt. They were all using debt to make money.
Huh.
What's interesting is that the third one, the one that got the basic cast out for being a slothful and not a wise servant, what's interesting is that he still paid the debt back, but that wasn't the charge and the commission he was given. They were saying, hey, you need to go do something with it. And they didn't say what to do with it. That's what's beautiful.
Yeah.
Everybody has their own path of how to create that. And the one that two that made four and the five that made 10, they got the same exact reward. Didn't matter how much they had, it's what they did.
Yeah.
They went and did what was asked of them. The guy that buried it out of fear, because he feared losing that money. He feared the debt, right? This is why I tell people, don't fear debt. Don't get angry about it because that doesn't work. Scarcity emotions don't help you become more financially free. They don't even create financial results that you want. But do respect it, because if there was a fourth steward, right, a fourth servant that was named Joe, was given three talents and blew all that money and came back and said, hey, I'm all out. What's next? If he was like the spender, that wouldn't have been good either, right? So I'm not saying people go into debt to do that, but I want you to open up your mind to the possibility that it's not debt that creates financial bondage like everybody claims. Banks want you to believe that, and that's why they teach all the financial experts to teach that. They want you to pay them back as fast as possible. But banks are the biggest debtors in the world. They're, in fact, the best stewards in the world, because they know how to take your money. They take your money as debt when you put money in a savings account, and they turn around and make more money from it. But if you're not a wise steward, if you're a spender or even a saver, you're not going to use it wisely. So avoid using debt in that case. But I've seen many cases.
Yeah, you know, I've heard it said many times too, where fear begins is where faith ends.
Yes.
You know, if we're fearing our money and we got to hoard it because for a rainy day or for, you know, the future, you know, you're fearing and fearing and fearing. And all of a sudden it's like, wow, faith just ended. You know, God, I got this. I got my stash. And you're not going, wow, I need to, you know, maybe having that X number of dollars in the savings account is my little, you know, security blanket. And maybe you're leading me to write a big old check to a missionary that just came through church. And I fear not having my safety blanket. And I think that plays into it as well. And I think it was in Job that said, behold, my greatest fears came to be. Meaning, wow, what you think about does come about. And it's not a metaphysical weird thing. It's just, boy, Colossians 3 says, set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are below. And I think that we too many times set our mind on things that are below, like money and you know, God says, look at the lilies of the field. If I'm going to make them look nice and they're here today, gone tomorrow, how about you? You're made in my image.
Yeah, faith and doubt cannot exist in the same person at the same time. Like it's like light and darkness. You know, when fear or doubt enters, faith flees. So how do you incorporate that? How do you increase your faith in what you're doing? And that's where you want to be a steward. And a steward's very different. Like you cannot follow traditional financial advice and be a wise steward. There's some aspects, like there's always half truths, right? Like for example, like Dave Ramsey, I tell people, like they're like, what do you think of his stuff? I say, hey, at least half of the stuff is good stuff. And if you're a spender, you're exactly the person that he's exactly the person you need. You know, I don't deal with spenders from that standpoint. I deal with people that want to be stewards, right? And there's a higher law. There's a higher level that comes with that. So you have to be careful.
So once you get someone's mindset and stewardship foundation and faith, you know, set, their values aligned, then you can probably move to the next level, which is helping them increase their cash flow. So what are some specific things that you would advise them to increase cash flow as the cash flow expert?
The first thing is I always have people track their money. You know, the law of attention states that whatever you put your attention towards expands and grows. The opposite is also true, which is the law of atrophy. Whatever you ignore will atrophy and decay. You know, it's just like your teeth. If you pay attention to your teeth, you're taking care of them, you're going to keep them. However, if you don't, you're going to lose them, right? Mm-hmm. Now, your physical health, same thing. When you take care of it, you keep it. When you don't, you lose it. Money's no different. In fact, if you notice, any principle, real principles, will apply in all areas of life. That's why high risk doesn't create high returns. You know, going eating at McDonald's 3 meals a day for 6 months does not create better returns of health. Just cholesterol, right? Money's the same way. And so I'm telling people, hey, track both money coming in and money going out. See, spenders, they only want to see what's coming in, but not what's going out. Savers only pay attention to what's going out, not what's coming in. They always focus on expenses and being as cheap as possible, living off rice and beans. I'm like, no, you got to pay attention to both. How do you focus on the money coming in and that flows out? And how do you keep that flow going and healthy? And you're keeping being aware of what's going on. And with that can come true creation and independence. I had one woman where she actually was spending $5,600 a month eating out.
Oh,
you know,
my word.
I brought her back to only, quote unquote, only $1,000 a month. So freed up the $4,600 a month. Plus we did some other things. And by the end of the year, we found an extra $70,000 that we freed up.
Good night.
I had a guy who was a dentist just in his practice alone, just from, you know, things that weren't working well in his practice, like marketing expenses that were wasted and this and that. I mean, we ended up freeing up $16,000 a month. You know, most people will usually find at least $300 to $500 a month pretty easily. That's pretty standard.
You know, and I think that some people would go, oh, well, I don't do $5,000 a month eating out. Well, you probably don't, but I'll bet you that you could, and I've thought this for years as well, is you write down every penny you spend for 60 days or 30 days, and let's look at it. And I've never said this to someone, but you in your business could. But I'll bet you that anybody, $150, $200 a month, we could find pure waste from just little
sure.
things. And it doesn't have to be the $5,000 eating out. And then if you put that money into some of those financial vehicles you're talking about or eliminating debt, now you found that accelerator. So I couldn't agree more. And I think that we kind of get lulled into, oh, I'm pretty good, I'm fine. And then you don't really look at it. And all of a sudden it's like, ooh, I'm not good.
Yeah, exactly. You know, that's the thing is that all progression begins with honesty. It begins with that awareness, right?
Yeah.
And so creating awareness, using little free tools like mint.com to track your money and make it easier to track, because I don't like using check registers and writing things down. I like to have something that's automated that I can spend 5 minutes a week and that's it. And I can be financially healthy with 5 minutes a week. So then you can go out and create value and bless people's lives. That's what we should be doing, right? So the money is just how you manage it.
Exactly. So what is your main business? What kind of customers do you help? What would make someone come to you and say, wow, I need your help? What are you going to do for them? What is your main product or service?
Yeah, the main people I help is usually an entrepreneur and their spouses. Like, I'm really good at bringing the two together, especially where one might be a spender, one might be a saver. Bringing them to get them meet in the middle as a stewards, right? I do best with entrepreneurs because we find the most money usually. We usually can help them make and increase income because expenses are great and we can free up lots of expenses. Like, I teach my ebook online, but there's a lot of ways to make more money and income's exponential. Like, it's unlimited. There's no cap. So we focus a lot on that, how to make more money, not just save money too. So those are the people I find on average at least $33,000 a year. And even sometimes I get people that are saying, hey, I like the idea of a business. I'm not sure what to do. But they might say, we got a lot of money saved up. You know, I got one client where he had, a couple hundred thousand in IRAs. We took just 80 or 90,000 of that. He bought 3 real estate properties. He's now cash flowing over $1,250 a month. And that's not including building equity in the properties. That's not including tax advantages and everything else. He's probably closer to $25,000 a year with those 3 properties with only 80 or 90,000. There's no financial.
And what was that earning in his IRA? 0.000%.
Exactly.
Even
if he's lucky, if the market smiles on him, he might make 5 or 6% net after fees and everything else, right?
Yep.
So it was a huge difference, and now it's creating a thing where he's like, hey, maybe in 10 years I could actually retire if I choose to, and that's awesome. That's a lot better than hoping that and praying that in 20, 30, or 40 years you save enough, which you won't, because all the numbers that they're showing you are a bunch of crap. So, people won't retire just doing the typical stuff. You have to save
$100,000
a year.
So using that example of the IRA, was there a way, did he have to take a penalty when he took it out, or was there a way to invest in that real estate within the IRA?
Yeah, we were able to avoid that by making a self-directed IRA. So we basically moved into an IRA where he gets to choose where to put the money, and then we use that to invest in the properties. No penalty, no taxes, even though he's in his 30s, no penalty or taxes at all, and we're able to use that money to make more money. And
he also bought
4 lots. Yeah, he's got another 4 properties he just bought where he probably cash, total cash, he can make about $100,000 extra on top of all that.
I think too many people think, IRA or 401k or some of these vehicles can't take money out with a penalty and taxes, so can't do it. But there are ways to do it. And I think just talking to the right person with the right perspective, like what you just mentioned, can really change it. And too many times we keep hearing that same old recording in our head, you can't do it this way, you can't do it that way. Well, sometimes you can, and sometimes you can't. So that's great, and that's wonderful. There are traditional things out there, laws of money, you should not take money out of your 401k because there is going to be a penalty. So that's true, but sometimes people just don't realize you can do the self-directed and invest in real estate like what you just mentioned. So I think that's a really good point.
And sometimes penalties are okay. I mean, I've had a few clients where we've used that money to pay off debt. Like, I had a guy that was about 40 years old. He cashed out from his 401k. He had to cash out $120,000 to then have a total of $70,000, but with refinancing and paying off certain loans with using a formula that I use that does not use the interest rate. In fact, I tell people to ignore the interest rate. But by doing that, with $70,000, we were able to free up $40,000 a year, which is huge, right? I mean, that's a massive difference in his life.
That's a
huge rate of return
on people. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, even though he had to cash $120,000 to pay the taxes and penalties, still making $40,000 a year guaranteed with $120,000 is pretty amazing. I mean, that's a 33% rate of return every year guaranteed.
And at his age, he could take a certain chunk of that and put it back into that retirement account, and the rest of it put it into living or investing or whatever. So I told someone literally this, we're doing a financial series in the Sunday school class that I teach at our church for college and career. And one of the co-sponsors, they're married and whatnot, and he goes, hey, I've got some questions for you. And I asked a question that he goes, ooh, I've never thought of that before. I said, well, how much does your employer match to your 401k? And he said 5%. And I said, how much are you putting more than 5% in? He goes, oh yeah. And he was like almost proud, right? You know, I'm doing way. And I said, stop it. I said, my opinion is this. If you put 1 or 2 or 3%, you're leaving money on the table. So go to the 5, but a dime over 5 is wasted money, because you just asked me about this massive consumer debt that you have that you want to chunk away. So drop it down to the 5%, and whatever the overage was there, start knocking out on your consumer debt. And he's like, that makes a lot of sense. And people just don't think that way. They think, oh, I'm putting away for retirement. Well, this guy's 32. He's got a lot of years for retirement, but he's dealing with consumer debt today.
Right. Yeah, and that's the cool thing about stewardship, is that everybody has different stewardship. I mean, when I have entrepreneurs, a lot of times I don't have them saving those plans, because, you know, for an employee, that might not be a bad idea to do up to the match. Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. But for an entrepreneur, I'm saying, why invest in everybody else's stock that gets gambled? You can be investing in your own company's stock, right?
Right.
I mean, I had one client where he had $50,000 in a college savings plan. And in his case, he's like, hey, how do I make this grow? I've got 5 or 6 years before my kids in college. I said, well, if you leave the mutual fund, maybe it'll make up to $70,000 if you're lucky. And we ran the numbers, and then he told me, hey, Chris, I can take $30,000 or $40,000, start up an office, and then turn around and sell that business 2 or 3 years later for $250,000. I said, wait, you can take $30,000 or $40,000 and make $250,000 in a couple of years? Yeah, I got down to a system. I said, once you cash out that college savings plan, use that money to start up an office, sell it 3 years later, do it again, and 2 or 3 years later, sell it again. You've made $500,000 in your control with $50,000. That
but
only
the
gets
difference
to go
there,
to college savings plan.
The scary thing there is, though, is this person had a proven history system formula, whereas some people would hear that and go, oh, I'm going to start this because I got this email from, or I went to this seminar this weekend. So I think the caveat there is you have to have this history and proven plan that you yourself have proven and made mistakes and failed and learned from. And now you know, when I put a dollar into this venture, I get $1.50 out, or whatever the calculations are. But I think that's the thing we have to focus on. There is part of that stewardship is we've got to have learned from the school of hard knocks so that we can say, okay, now the next time I do it, I'm going to do it differently. And oh, hey, it worked. And then the next time, oh, hey, it worked. And then now you confidently can say, when I put $30,000 in, I can sell for.
Exactly. Are you the steward that can take 5 pounds and turn it into 10? Are you really that person? Or are you the guy that has 3 and then blows it all?
Yeah, now you owe 3. So now you're upside down.
Exactly. Exactly. It's about stewardship.
Well, you know, I think we could probably talk for 4 more hours and still have about 3 days worth of content to talk about. So let's go ahead and wrap up with what would you say a final thought is? If you were to say to someone listening to this, what would something be that might be, ooh, I had not thought about that. This is something that I could get clarified and Chris could help me with that. What would that one final thought be, do you think?
You know, I talk about the cash flow creates freedom. You know, I think that's really big, because cash flow creates options, that creates freedom. And I'll tell you the one principle that my millionaire friends taught me that really got me to shift everything, and it really got me to retire. It wasn't about what's the coolest investment. In fact, they never told me about any investments. They just taught me true principles, because true principles are eternal. They never change. Strategies change over time. You know, whether you're trying to save up money, pay off a debt or whatever, those are all strategies, not principles. But the one principle I focused on was that dollars follow value. Dollars follow the value that you create for other people. If you want to make more money, never ever ask, how do I make more money? That's a false question. Nobody's ever made money from it. But start asking, how do I create more value for more people? And that's actually what I started doing. Like, I became really good at connecting people together, and then I got paid from that. I didn't have to do all the work. I was really good at farming out work to people because I was good at seeing the big picture and making connections. That's how I was making $4,000 or $5,000 a month working 3 hours a week, because I was good at using those talents to create value. I wasn't trying to take away from people. In fact, the only way you can truly get wealthy is by serving people, solving problems, and adding value in their lives in a way that money is the natural byproduct. That is the key to wealth right there.
I agree with that 1,000%, and it's kind of like the old saying that Zig Ziglar, I think, was the main one known for, although sometimes people claim it. But if you help other people get what they want in their life, then you will end up getting what you want in your life, because the focus is not on you. It's putting others first
right.
And giving that value, because in reality, I thought of this example too, which is the perfect tie-in and close to your last statement. I think it was Think and Grow Rich, that whole story of the Andrew Carnegie days where he goes into this steel mill and was talking about time management, and he was this consultant, and he says, hey, I can help you turn around your steel mill. And he says, how much do you charge? And he goes, guess what? Let me give you some advice, and then you tell me how much it's worth. Now, this is a story, and maybe there's little elements that are embellished, but the concept still works. And the point is, he said, have your key people every night write down what they're going to do tomorrow, the top 5 or 6 things, and when they come in that morning, they start at number 1. They don't do anything else until they finish. They go to number 2 and so forth. They don't get distracted. They do those things. And then when their list is done, they move on to the things that kind of, you know, come at them. And months later, as the story goes, he sent a check for like just some incredible amount of money. And the point was, we became so focused and so effective. But when you think about it, it's exactly what you said. He gave so much value. The value of his advice was not the hour and a half or the one comment that he made to this guy. It was so much value to his business that it was worth him writing this massive check back to him.
That's right. That's exactly
it. I love it. And sometimes it's that one little thing that we say to a person, a friend, or a client that really is the trigger for them. So really have enjoyed getting to know you. And let's close with, what is your website and best phone number or best way for people to get in touch with you to learn more?
Yeah, my website's www.moneyripples.com. That's MoneyRipples.com. You actually download a free ebook on there called Beyond Rice and Beans, 7 Secrets to Free Up Cash Today. You know, if you've got questions, you're like, hey, I'd love to get a real hands-on approach. Like, I'm actually willing to offer a free money leak evaluation with my team. You can just email me, Chris, that's with a C-H, at moneyripples.com. We can do that for you.
Excellent. Super. Well, thank you for the offer, and thank you for your time today. It was great to learn more about your business.
Oh, it's been a pleasure. I appreciate it.
Thanks for listening to Business Innovators Radio. To hear all episodes featuring leading industry influencers and trendsetters, visit us online at businessinnovatorsradio.com today.